Let us derive the shape functions of the CST element in global, local and natural coordinate. Before that, you can just go through this. This is just a brief note on CST element. Here is the application of the CST element, which tells us where we can use this CST element or where we should try to avoid using this CST element. And of course, there are some limitations to this CST element. Especially, we can observe the limitations of these elements in bending problem, and something called as mesh lock takes place. Mesh lock, and it is observed mostly in the material which has a Poisson's ratio approaching to 0.5. But nevertheless, because of its simplicity, this element is widely used in many problems, at least for the quick and preliminary FE analysis. So looking at all this, let us start deriving the shape functions in global coordinates. Now, this is our typical element which we had seen last time. Again, the numbering of this element, numbering of these nodes in this element is always done in anticlockwise direction to avoid the problem of negative area. So here is the one first node, here is the second node, and here is the third node in anticlockwise manner. And these are the degrees of freedom. Now, the horizontal degrees of freedom or the degrees of freedom in x direction is given by q1, q3 and q5, whereas the degree of freedom in the vertical direction or in y direction is given by q2, q4 and q6. Now, if I just try to replace this values q1, q2, q3, q4, q5, q6 with u1, v1, I will get it somewhat like this. Basically, this is the same element which is shown here, but only thing is this odd numbers q1, q3, q5 have been replaced by u1, u2, u3, and these even numbers q2, q4, q6 has been replaced by v1, v2 and v3. Now, to begin with the derivation, since this is a constant strain triangle element, we can call this element as a two-dimensional linear element. And if it is a two-dimensional linear element, we'll have to assume a linear displacement function, and that can be given as q of x comma y, which is nothing but q's are nothing but degrees of freedom, which I have represented here as u and v, and this can be assumed as a naught plus a1 x plus a2 y, and v can be assumed as a3 plus a4 x plus a5 y. So u will be assumed a linear displacement function for u will be assumed as a naught plus a1 x plus a2 y, and for v it will be assumed as a3 plus a4 x plus a5 y. As we had discussed in our previous videos, this a naught stands for a rigid body motion of this element. Anyways, then further, I can write this u as 1 x and y, that is the rho vector, times a naught, a1 and a2. And similarly, this v can be written as 1 x y, and then this will be a3, a4, a5, where this a0, a1, a2, a3, a4, a5 are some mathematical unknown quantities, and in finite element method we know that we try to replace these unknown mathematical quantities a0, a1, a1, a2 or a3, a4, a5 with the unknowns at the nodes. For example, here, since we have taken the displacement function for u as this, we will try to replace this a0, a1, a2 with that of u1, u2 and u3. If I do that, I can do that in the following fashion. We can say that u will be equal to u1, u will be equal to u1 at x equal to x1. Similarly, u will be equal to u2 at x equal to x2, and u will be equal to u3 at x equal to x3. Now if I substitute all this here in this equation, I will get u1 is equal to, I will get u1 is equal to, and then this will be y will be equal to y1 here. Here y will be equal to y2, and here y will be equal to y3. Therefore, we will get u1 as a0 plus a1 x1 plus a2 y1. Similarly, I'll get u2 as a0 plus a1 x2 plus a2 y2. Similarly, u3 will be equal to a0 plus a1 x3 plus a2 y3. And then if I write this in a matrix form, I'll get this as u1, u2, u3 is equal to this. I will get it as 1 x1 y1, this I will get it as 1 x2 y2, this I'll get it as 1 x3 y3 multiplied by a0 a1 and a2. So our aim is to find this a0 a1 a2 in terms of u1 u2 u3, and for that what I will have to do is I will have to take the inverse of this matrix. Then what we'll get further here is I'll get this as a0 a1 a2 is equal to inverse of this matrix, that is 1 x1 y1, 1 x2 y2, and 1 x3 y3, inverse of this matrix times I'll get this as u1, u2, u3. The inverse of this matrix can be found as cofactor transpose of this matrix divided by determinant of this matrix. So if I take the inverse of this matrix, I should get the inverse of this matrix as this will be x2 y3 minus x3 y2. Then the second term will be x3 y1 minus x1 y3, and the third term will be x1 y2 minus x2 y1. Similarly here, this term will be y2 minus y3, this term will be y3 minus y1, and this term will be x1 minus x3. Similarly, this term will be x3 minus x2, this term will be x1 minus x3, and this term will be x2 minus x1. And then we have this term u1, u2, u3. So and then of course here there will be 1 by 2 times ae. This will be equal to a0, a1 and a2. Now what I can do is where this AE is nothing but the area of the element, and that can be given as this area of the element can be given as half of 1 1 1. Then this will be x1 x2 x3, and this will be y1 y2 y3. This should be determinant of this matrix. That is, area will be half of determinant of this matrix. So this is what we get as this is what we obtain the value of this unknown mathematical parameters, that is a0, a1, a2, in terms of unknowns at the nodes, that is u1, u2, u3. Further, if I denote these terms as alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, finally I can write this a0, a1, a2 as 1 by 2 times AE, 1 by 2 times AE, this will be alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, this will be beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, and this will be gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3, and of course this is multiplied by u1, u2 and u3. So this is what I have obtained, the values of a0, a1, a2 in terms of u1, u2 and u3. Further, if you just want to see how to find the inverse of this matrix, I'm sure you must be knowing it, or if you want to just have a look at how to find the inverse of this matrix, you can just go through these steps of finding the inverse of this matrix. The inverse of this matrix is found as the cofactor transpose of this matrix, the transpose of the cofactor of this matrix divided by determinant of this matrix. And then to find the cofactors of this matrix, this is the procedure which we are well aware of. And then finally, once you find the cofactor, we need to take the transpose of those cofactor. And then if I divide that matrix by determinant of this initial matrix, I should get the inverse of this matrix, which I have written here. So this is how we can find the relation between the unknown mathematical terms, that is a0, a1, and a2, with that of the unknowns at the nodes u1, u2, and u3, where alpha 1 is nothing but this term x2 y3 minus x3 y2. Alpha 2 is this term. Alpha 3 is this term, and so on. Therefore, finally, what we will do is we'll substitute this a0, a1, a2, the values of a0, a1, a2 as this matrix here in this place. So if I do that, if I substitute the values of a0, a1, a2 here in this case, so I will get u finally as this vector, this row vector 1xy. So u will be finally, what we'll get is u will be the row vector 1xy times 1 by 2a, that is this, in place of a0, a1, a2, I will substitute this alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. This will be beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, and this will be gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3 times u1, u2, u3. So I have been able to find the displacement function in terms of unknowns at the nodes u1, u2, u3. Further, to find now the shape functions, what I need to do is I need to multiply this matrix of 1 by 3 with that of 3 by 3, which will give me the new row vector of 1 by 3, because this 3 and this 3 will cancel out. Finally, I'll get a row vector of 1 by 3. And how I can do that is I will have to multiply this with this, which will give me 1 by 2a times, this will be alpha 1 plus beta 1x plus gamma 1y. So this will be my first term in this matrix. This will be my first term. The second term will be again alpha 2 plus beta 2x plus gamma 2y. And then the third term will be alpha 3 plus beta 3x plus gamma 3y. And all this will be multiplied by u1, u2, u3. And then if I look at this carefully, I can write this term as u is equal to this multiplied by this. I can call it as my first shape function. And then this multiplied by this, I can call it as my second shape function. And again, this multiplied by this, I can call it as my third shape function times u1, u2, u3. So this is what I get. I get now my displacement function as u equal to n1 u1 plus n2 u2 plus n3 u3. So I get this u as n1 u1 plus n2 u2 plus n3 u3. So this is my displacement equation for finite element method, or specially for that of CST element. If I follow the similar procedure for v, I will again get, I'll get that v as n1, n2, n3 times v1, v2, v3. So this is nothing but v will be equal to n1, v1 plus n2, v2 plus n3, v3. So these are my shape functions, where n1 is nothing but, as I had said, n1 is nothing but 1 by 2a times alpha 1 plus beta 1x plus gamma 1y. Similarly, n2 will be 1 by, again, n2 will be also equal to 1 by 2a times alpha 2 plus beta 2x plus gamma 2y. And similarly, n3 will be 1 by 2a times the last term. Fine. So this is how I can derive the shape function in terms of a global coordinates. And then if I try to plot this shape function, the property of the shape functions will be such that this n1 will be equal to 1 at node 1, and it will be 0 at other nodes. So n1 will be equal to 1 here at node 1, and it will be 0 at node 2 and node 3. So in that case, if I plot this, I will be able to see that since the variation will be linear, because our assumed trial function was a linear trial function, the variation will be linear, and what will happen is it will linearly move to 0 from node 1 to node 2 and from node 1 to node 3. So here at this point n1 will be equal to 1. Similarly, if I plot the variation of this second shape function n2, it will be 1 at node 2, whereas it will be 0 at other nodes 1 and 3. Then if I try to plot the variation of this shape function, it will look somewhat like this. It will be n2 will be equal to 1, n2 will be equal to 1 at node 2, whereas it will be 0 at node 3. Whereas the third variation will look somewhat like this. The third variation will be, it will be equal to 1 at node 3, it will be equal to 0 at node 1 and 2. So if I plot the variation, it will look somewhat like this. It will be 1 at node 3, this n3 will be 1 at node 3, whereas it will be 0 at node 1 and node 2. So this is the derivation of shape function in terms of global coordinates. So again, just to revise, I get the shape functions of global coordinate n1, n2, n3 as n1 will be equal to 1 by 2ae times alpha 1 plus beta 1 x plus beta plus gamma 2 y. And then n2 will be this and n3 will be this. So this will be our shape functions of CST element in terms of global coordinates. Again, where alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 are nothing but these terms. Beta 1, beta 2, beta 3 will be these terms. Whereas gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 3 will be these terms. All these terms are in terms of global coordinate system.